Let's begin this class with a problem. You're president of the United States. You're in your fourth year in office. You'd like to serve for four more. How do you do it? How do you maximize your chances for re-election? And how do you do it in a way that will not seem like you're doing it at all? Well, this is the problem Richard Nixon faces, and perhaps has faced for his entire term of office.
Tonight, The Presidential Advantage, with NPACT correspondent Robert MacNeil.
When President Nixon left for China, one had to be very naive, or a member of the White House press office, not to think the trip had political overtones. We're not concerned tonight with the diplomatic meaning of the trip. Maybe some time before that's fully clear in any case. We wish to look at the China trip as a very timely example of the kind of event a president, any president seeking election, can time to capture the nation's attention. President Nixon is not the only occupant of the White House in recent history to exploit the advantages of incumbency to campaign for re-election. It's in the nature of an elective office holder to do so, and the presidential advantages are unique. He can not only command instant public attention, but can preempt the issues. He can legislate and dispense the federal budget to please his political constituency. Or if Congress frustrates him, he can use Congress as a whipping boy. He can command service and loyalty through vast patronage. And he can keep a political organization intact and well-financed. But the advantages are not all on the president's side. He and his performance are constant political targets. In the past 100 years, only four presidents have been re-elected after serving full four-year terms: McKinley, Wilson, Franklin Roosevelt, and Eisenhower. Four other presidents who tried to be re-elected after serving 4 years were rejected by the country: Cleveland, Harrison, Taft, and Hoover. We've taken our NPAC cameras to the classrooms of two president watchers. At American University, we filmed Washington-based political scientist Dr. Thomas E. Cronin.
Ladies and gentlemen, today I'd like to discuss the presidential advantage of the incumbency. The question that
second
like
president watcher is Stephen Wayne, professor of political science at George Washington University.
Consistent in their voting choices on election day. Now, President Nixon has a great advantage in running for re-election. He has the majesty of the office, and the office itself creates a type of halo effect that radiates around its occupant. Americans look up to the president. He is the best known and best respected public official. He is the first person to come to the attention of young children.
I think he's a nice man.
Why?
Because he helps our country, makes a lot of nice speeches.
He's nice, considerate, and works hard.
He's the president of the United States. He takes over the United States.
He's a top man. I mean, that's why his home is important. Everything about him is important.
And the onus falls on him.
The man has a very, very important job. A job that is probably the most important in the whole world, as far as I'm concerned.
He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole wide world in his hands. He's got the whole wide world in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got you and me, brother,
in his hands.
He's got you and me, sister.
of a national church, a royalty, the White House sometimes has become almost a national shrine, and the presidency somewhat of a bloated superhuman monument. The incumbent can more easily command headline attention as well as substantial TV exposure. He is much better known than any of his challenges, and this name recognition is no small advantage.
Nixon on his way to Tanner. Nixon on the way to Tanner. Nixon on the way to Tanner.
The president can dominate the news. He has limitless possibilities to make news. One single press conference gets more attention than weeks of congressional debate.
Nixon on his way to Tanner.
He is the one American official who can speak for the entire nation. Now remember, I suggested that there's a certain majesty about the presidency. It is and should be an occasion when the president goes on nationwide television. People should stop what they're doing to watch the president. Therefore, a president has to be very careful that he doesn't come on once a week or once every 2 weeks.
Especially if they are preempting programs such as All in the Family or hockey games or other primetime favorites. Also, the American public, or so it seems to me, can see through government by press release, government by international grandstanding, government by public relations.
Mr. Vice President, Mr. Speaker, members of the Congress and members of the Cabinet, I want to express my very deep appreciation to all of you who have come here to send us off on this historic mission. And I particularly want to express appreciation to the bipartisan leadership of the House and Senate who are here. Their presence and the messages that have poured in from all over the country to the White House over the past few days, wishing us well on this trip, I think underline the statement that I made on July 15th last year when I announced the visit. And that statement was, as you will recall, that this would be a journey for peace.
Anytime the president wants to go on nationwide television, nationwide media, it's available to him free of charge. And there's no question that that's an advantage. The only way you can offset that is to just outwork him.
We don't have the money to match the president's command of the news media, but the independent judgment up here in New Hampshire, I think, sees behind this Madison Avenue trip to Peking concept.
The president commands the news media, and he can say it's not politics, but everybody knows that it is.
But his publicity prerogative and commanding exposure can also turn to his distinct disadvantage. Presidents have to be exceedingly mindful of not wearing out their welcome in the living rooms of America. I believe we denigrate ourselves as an enlightened people when we suggest that just because the incumbent's name is better known and he possesses a near limitless capacity to make news, he therefore is assured of the majority of the public's vote. There is a widely held belief in this country that the presidency should be above politics, that presidents should be motivated by ideology or by principles or by the public interest or the common cause, but certainly not by politics and by personal ambition. But the telling contradiction here is that such a belief presupposes a different type of political system than ours, which is held together in such large part by ambiguity, compromise, bargaining, and separation of powers. The reality is that ambition lies at the heart of politics, and politics, or the practice of the art of politics, is a basic requisite for carrying out the presidential job. A president can dramatize his foreign policy responsibilities, and he can pose as a statesman, engaging in summit meetings, visiting the UN, and nearly always having an apparent bipartisan or non-political cover. Cabinet, sub-cabinet, and White House aides and other governmental officials can tour the country raising funds and votes for the incumbent president, taking on the task of refuting his challenges, arguments, and thereby permitting the president to appear above name-calling.
An impressive army of stand-ins have been giving the chore of fighting through the New England winter to the tiny meetings in small towns of New Hampshire. Unless Mr. Nixon changes his mind at the last moment, the snows of New Hampshire aren't going to touch the presidential feet this primary. This Friday, they're going to have a mammoth rally here in New Hampshire to cap it all with movie stars, cabinet ministers, senators, governors, perhaps even Vice President Agnew. And they will follow a long army of the loyal who've come up here to extol the president's policies while Mr. Nixon has been pretending it wasn't going on at all and just going on being president himself. There were senators and governors, congressmen, members of the cabinet, Richardson, Volpe, and the gentleman whose own presidential ambitions were frozen out here in New Hampshire 4 years ago, George Romney.
My mini campaign was like a mini skirt. It was short and revealing. Now, what it really disclosed to me was that the man that I came up here to oppose was particularly qualified to be president of the United States. He had exceptional qualifications in the international field and in the domestic field, and as one who has been a part of his inner circle and official family, and as I've had an opportunity to see him work at the various problems of this nation, my conviction in that respect is much greater than it was just 3 years ago.
Don't you think this trip is having a profound political impact in this state, in this primary campaign?
I think it may have that result, but that's not the purpose.
Well, I sat in the White House 2 years ago when the president told us the timing was everything. He was talking to young Republican congressmen saying that, look, stay with me now and I'll protect you. It's just before the election and I have the sole power to time my moves and to take over the national media.
I am sure that anyone who looks at the thing logically knows that in dealing with an international government which hasn't opened its doors for over 23 years, you're not about to be able to time anything in that kind of a relationship to any one state or an election.
Pictures and stories of the historic meeting, and it mentioned that the American president was one of the few visitors to China who got to see the 78-year-old Chinese leader on the first day. The president was escorted to the party chairman's home by Premier Zhou Enlai. The greeting by Mao for Mr. Nixon was pictured as being cordial. The meeting was held within a few hours of the president's arrival in Peking. There will be a
beautiful thing about the timing of the trip. It diverts for the key period of debate before the election any attention to the real problems here at home. The problems in this country are here. They're not in Peking. And yet for 10 days, the American president has been able to divert public opinion to a common challenge, a common confrontation, 15,000 miles away, and something that we all tend to sympathize with the president, hope that he's successful, hope that we can understand these people. I think we're tired of war. We're tired of confrontation. It's a beautifully, politically timed effort. The terrible thing is that it doesn't help us at all in the Vietnam War. We're still bombing in Cambodia and Laos today. The real issue of our time is effectively set behind people's thinking.
What good do you think, if any, this is doing the president here in New Hampshire in the primary? What relevance has all this got to the New Hampshire primary?
Well, I think, first of all, he's got all the media. We're watching Chinese ballet, Chinese duck, Chinese wine, the problems of unemployment, of inflation, of continuing the war, of a fiscal deficit of $38 billion. Nobody's thinking about those things, and any candidate that talks about them isn't getting much attention.
Do you think it is in the president's power to command the media whenever he wants?
Yes, I think it is, and I think this is properly so. When the president of the United States chooses to exercise this option, it's important that he be able to lead the country behind a common concept. It's unfortunate just prior to an election when the attempting
to seek name recognition, to seek debate on the issues. He uses that ability to divert attention away from the great issues that this country should be deciding on knowledgeably. The interesting thing here in New Hampshire is I think people perceive this. I think it's well understood that he's making a great political ploy. The sympathy is with him in China. But I think there's a kind of a common understanding that he's doing this for political purposes primarily.
I think it'd be a mistake in any way to connect the trip or its timing to this primary or to the election. The fact is that the work to develop the trip to China has gone on for 3 years. It's been slow. It's been difficult. When you're dealing with the Chinese, I'm sure they're not interested in helping or perhaps not even hurting someone in elections. So I see no connection.
He'll time his trip to Moscow just before the California primary, and probably by the time of the conventions next fall, before the November election, he'll be meeting with the premier of India and Israel and Arab leaders. This guy is beautiful at timing his actions to divert public attention away from the problems that are political problems for him. No question, he's the master politician of this era.
But here in New Hampshire, Mr. Nixon is taking no chances. He calls this Nixon country, and he got 79% of the vote in 1968. But much less than that would be a bad start on the glorious march to re-election. So the presidential forces are preparing for overkill. They're mounting a political B-52 raid to squash two grasshoppers, McCloskey and Ashbrook. Representative Paul McCloskey is running to stop the war. He's been campaigning here for 10 months. He has very little money and a small army of political amateurs. Representative John Ashbrook has been here only 2 months.
Most of your life, the leaders tell you. But the interesting thing about a primary, that's the one time, Captain, where the people have a chance to tell the leaders.
He has a long list of conservative promises he says Mr. Nixon has broken.
But he's in the position of having to defend a record which is totally different than what he promised the American people, and Republicans in particular, in 1968. So I'd rather have my uphill battle than try to defend a $50 billion deficit this year, controls, guaranteed incomes, and the type of programs that he now is sponsoring and promoting, which the American people, in my opinion, just plain don't want, and Republicans in particular.
He has even less money and fewer workers, but he has a strong, reputed ally in the conservative newspaper, the Manchester Union Leader. Together, McCloskey and Ashbrook are unlikely to achieve what both of them would consider a grave defeat for Mr. Nixon, 50% or less of the vote. Neither of them has found any issue potent enough to compete with presidential prestige and with the state Republican organization which Mr. Nixon controls. But as I said, Mr. Nixon is taking no chances.
This election is so important to this country, not only the primary election in New Hampshire, but across this land. Because if you let men like Dick Nixon go down the chute that have gone ahead and done the job in favor of big talkers, then believe you me, the greatness of this country is going to be measured in terms of our lifetime rather than infinity.
Mr. Nixon may be able to use the resources of the presidency to clobber his own Republican opposition here in New Hampshire. But his real task is to destroy the Democrats, and there the presidential apparatus has been less effective. The Democrats may be divided a dozen ways on their presidential nominee. They may be $9 million in debt. But somehow their front runner, Senator Muskie, runs Mr. Nixon a very close race in the polls. He's been doing that for more than a year now, and that's a big plus for him here in New Hampshire. He has a comfortable lead here.
Now, what do you teach?
Well, I've got my job. You've got to get yours now.
He's the president of the union, Senator. Hey.
You get the one I've got. And I hope you have all luck in the world.
Thanks very much.
This is the way the political process turns over. And the challenger, of course, has to make his case. He's the challenger, and so he has to make the prima facie case, to put it in lawyer's terms, for change. And the incumbent has all the advantages that implies. But I've never found it an insuperable obstacle. After all, I've come this far.
But there's a small swarm of Democrats who are trying to cut him down here in New Hampshire. For instance, Senator George McGovern has been campaigning in the state for more than a year. He's very well organized and well financed. He's keen on the issues and on attack. But so far, he's failed to hit even 20% in the polls.
You just got to show strength, but I don't have any percentage in mind. But we're going to do well in both New Hampshire and Massachusetts.
You think you're picking up coverage?
Oh, I know we are. Yeah, we're picking up strength. I have personally thought we ought to try to improve our relations with China years ago, but I think it's fair to say the president timed this visit to help him to the maximum extent in the year when he's up for re-election. Now, frankly, I'm glad he's going in any event, even if it helps him politically. I think it's in the interest of our country to try to improve our relations with China, and I wish the president good luck on this mission.
Everything about the China trip, from the departure to the arrival back in Washington, was minutely stage-managed for maximum drama and public attention. It was not without political risks for Mr. Nixon, but every effort was made to anticipate and minimize the risks. Technology continues to add fabulous new tools to the already immense power of the presidency to create its own image. Helicopters and gleaming jet planes to whisk the president around the world. Television to carry him into our very homes. And now, the power to do that even when he's in the remotest corner of the globe by satellite television. All at the expense of the taxpayer or the obliging television networks. But if all this seems to add up to an insuperable advantage for the incumbent president, to make him seem larger, more important, more heroic than any of his opponents, there are still dangers. Any president likes to pretend to be above politics. His opponents inevitably charge that all his motives are political. But the more blatantly a president exploits his own publicity value, the more he invites charges like those we've heard, that events like the China trip are just political stunts, which is clearly too sour a verdict. One of the great problems for any president is how to pursue the national interest without being accused of acting politically. In any case, this election will turn on more than dramatic summit meetings. Powerful issues like the state of the economy do not respond so easily to the presidential wand, which may be why so many contenders for his job are not overwhelmed this year by the presidential advantage.
Despite the ring of bipartisanship that accompanied the announcement that the Senate's Democratic and Republican leaders Mike Mansfield and Hugh Scott had been invited to China by Premier Zhou Enlai, despite the generally broad acceptance of the aims and results of the president's trip, he still faces political thunder on the right and on the left. On the right, conservative Republican Congressman John Ashbrook, running in the New Hampshire primary, has been joined by columnist William Buckley, in charging the president with the betrayal of the Chinese nationalist government on Taiwan. On the Democratic side, it's very likely that before long, one of the presidential candidates will raise this question and try to make it an issue. That if the president can reverse a misguided national policy toward China and can modify or alter our treaty relationships with one ally, nationalist China, then why would it not be possible to modify or alter or end our relationship with another ally, South Vietnam, a country with whom we have no formal treaty obligations, nor any of the emotional ties that so long bound us to Chiang Kai-shek?
The question Democratic strategists, like everyone else in Washington, has been asking is what President Nixon got in return for his apparent concessions over Taiwan. The political logic, or the political wishful thinking, all points to Vietnam. But no amount of scrutiny of the Shanghai communique or official explanations of it has turned up any substance. Democratic candidates will just have to wait for Mr. Nixon to drop the other shoe, if in fact there is another shoe.
The issue of school busing dominates the congressional scene today and will continue to do so for some time. It is likely in the weeks ahead it will also dominate the presidential primaries even more. One overlooked effect of the emphasis that candidates like George Wallace will put on the issue is that women, mothers, will turn out in greater numbers than they usually do to vote in the primaries. It is their fears about busing, real or imagined, that will probably bring them out in greater numbers, especially in the Florida primary just 2 weeks away.
Here are a few last-minute notes on next week's New Hampshire primary. Muskie still appears well in the lead. There's evidence that his support is soft, but even his opponents in New Hampshire don't see any big erosion. His emotional attack on the Manchester Union leader when Muskie broke down and wept is regarded as less significant in New Hampshire than outside the state. One late development which could hurt Muskie is the mailing yesterday of 100,000 letters inviting New Hampshire Democrats to write in the name of Senator Edward Kennedy. Surveys have shown that Kennedy is the first choice of a significant number of New Hampshire voters. If New Hampshire shows any surprises this year, a number of observers think it could be in a large vote, perhaps as high as 30%, for President Nixon's challenger, California Representative Paul McCluskey.
If money is the mother's milk of politics, Senator McGovern this week decided to take the voters on a tour of the dairy. He disclosed the names and addresses of every contributor to his campaign and listed separately the names of individuals who have given him $1,000 or more. Republican presidential candidate Congressman Paul McCluskey today pretty much followed McGovern's example. Thus far, however, no stampede on the part of other candidates to list their contributors. When the new federal disclosure law takes effect April 7th, all candidates will be required to open their books. But by then, four primaries, New Hampshire, Florida, Illinois, and Wisconsin, will have taken place. And it will be anybody's guess who gave what and to whom. Next week, we'll have a report on how money is being spent in the Florida primary. And we'll also examine the results of the New Hampshire primary. Until then, this is Sander Vanocur for MPACT.
This program has been a production of NPACT, the National Public Affairs Center for Television.